Greetings from Asbury Park. That's something I've always wanted to say, and what an honor it is to be recording my 100th episode of my podcast in beautiful, sunny Asbury Park, right on the Atlantic Ocean, at arguably one of the greatest rock photographers of all time, Danny Clinch's fantastic transparent gallery. And I am so excited to bring you my special guest for episode 100, the mighty Max Weinberg. Of course, the legendary Rock and Roll Hall of Fame drummer for over 47 years with Bruce Springsteen in the E Street Band and 16 years with Conan O'Brien late night. When Max is not touring with Bruce, he is very busy touring with his own bands over the years. Right now, you can see the Max Weinberg jukebox playing this summer and this fall everywhere. So let's go inside and let's sit down for episode 100 with my special guest, the mighty Max Weinberg. So I think it's only proper to welcome you today, not just as Max or Mighty Max, but Mr. Commissioner. I mean, many people may not be aware of your recent appointment to the Delray Beach, Florida Planning and Zoning Board.
That's right. I am. Yes, you can address me as, you know, Commissioner.
Is it Mr. Commissioner?
Mighty Commissioner.
Mighty Commissioner, Mighty Max. Your Honor. I wasn't sure if
well,
it
you
Neil,
know,
I didn't know how it works.
Actually, the way our city of Delray Beach, the government there works is you have a city commission, which is like a council, and they're actually commissioners. I'm a board member of the Planning and Zoning, which is something I've had an interest in for probably 40 years, mostly on the other side of the table. And in applications in various jurisdictions, whether it was in Los Angeles, Arizona, Connecticut, New York City, Florida, Pennsylvania, New Jersey,
right.
You know. So I kind of knew the issues, and a lot of it is it's very interesting to me because it has to do with where do you see a city 20, 30, 40 years in the future, where you can really affect it based on the comprehensive plan that all cities are mandated to have. So I'm not sort of a Johnny-come-lately to it. I've been involved in these issues for probably the last 40 years. And now at the ripe old age of 70, I'm able to use the knowledge and put it into practical use. Like most of our discourse in the country, politically leading the way, there's such discord and factionalism, you know, black or white issues. And what I try to do is go down the middle and get people talking, whether it's in our town, for example. It could be the extensive discussions between preservation, because we're called the Village by the Sea, and it really is that. It's a four-story town. You don't have big condos on the water, that kind of thing. And you have those that constituency, and then you also have development. So how do you balance it? How do you do smart growth? You have to have smart growth. You have to have, in your business, you know all about rateables. You have to have rateables. And if you don't have expensive condos on the beach, where are you going to get it? So the pockets of development, where you develop, how you develop. I have a meeting on the Monday after we've taped this, next Monday. We do it once a month. It's not a lot of heavy lifting. And it actually massages a part of my brain that I don't use in necessarily in the performing space. So it ties in with my short-lived legal career back in the 90s. Went to law school for 6 weeks and thought better of it. So I guess I've always sort of had that in me.
And what about the architecture part? Because I know that's always fascinated you, and that obviously continues.
Well, I was a kid, and there's so many pictures of me with the actually Froebel blocks. Froebel blocks were what they're still sold. They're what got Frank Lloyd Wright interested in architecture back in the 19th century. And I was very good at building things. I was terrible at putting model planes and things together. And my problem was I wasn't patient enough to get to the end where you put on the stickers, and my glue was kind of, you know, my approach was a little bit more Frank Gehry than pristine, if you know what I mean. So I always had the ability to think in the abstract, which is helpful for architecture. And when I was 14, whether it was which would have been early 65, maybe my parents worried about me, so they, I was subjected to a battery of mental and emotional tests at Stevens Institute of Technology with, like, okay, where's, is this rock and roll thing really, you know, if it is, if it's real, then fine, you know. I, unlike many of my colleagues, got tremendous support from my parents throughout the late 50s and 60s as a drummer, to be a drummer. But I tested, and they, then they give you this, it's not an IQ test, but it's sort of a aptitude test of sorts. And what came out was that I had a very good chance to be a good architect. So I was always very interested in that and building. There's pictures of me with, you know, when I was a little kid, I wanted to be a heavy equipment operator.
Right.
Because I could name every steam shovel and steam shovel, I'm dating myself, So architecture and real estate development was not only in my, I guess, blood to a certain degree, it was in my familial heritage, and it was something I had a feel for. And I don't write songs, and particularly in the early days of the East Street Band, when we weren't touring all the time, there was a lot of time off. This is back when I was in my 20s. So I sort of devoted that time off to educating myself, both you know, academically in both real estate development, real estate in general, architecture specific and generalized, and also getting my feet wet by investing, and mostly single family residences. And what I learned during that period, which has been very helpful in this new position as a board member of the planning and zoning, is the timing of everything. For example, right now we have the boom of all booms going on in Florida as a result of mass exodus from cities. And it's funny because, you know, I talk to my real estate friends, realtors, you know, during the so-called downturn of 07, 08, and 09, everybody's complaining about, you know, it's dead. Now everybody's complaining is they don't have a life anymore because there's, they're so busy. You know,
And there's no, so little there's no inventory. Homes. It's hard to find them. I mean,
it's very hard
it's
to
really,
find
It's really, really challenging. And up here in the New York area, it's been incredible. In the town I live in, it's unbelievable how many homes have sold in the last year. And I actually live in a Stanford White house that was built for the mass. It's built for the mass Marvel when they built when he built Madison Square Garden in 1900.
Stanford White, incredible. You know, the this area of the shore was a fount of work for the McKean, Mead, and White firm back then. Rumson, and even that, even right across from Convention Hall, there were Stanford White homes.
So before
now we're really getting into the weeds.
All right. So before we get into any more weeds, I just like to check in anyway with every guest about the pandemic and. And everybody's fine. I know, you know, you've weathered it. You hang it. You hung in there. You did spend five wonderful Monday nights for all the Bruce fans. To thanks to Backstreets, and shout out to Chris for putting it together and answering all those questions. But how was that whole experience for you? Like you said, when you walked in, I haven't been out much. I mean,
well, it was, you know, thank God we seem to be seeing some daylight. Florida, of course, where I live. You know, apart from businesses just being closed, you know, we had quite a difficult time convincing people that it was a real thing. So for much of it, particularly in 2020, I remember I did three dates in January, one in January, one in February, and March. March 7th was the last time I played. It was in the private event in the Bahamas, and COVID had just started, you started to really think that this was more than a flu. And I realized, and of course we were very lucky, you know, extraordinarily lucky, my Becky, my wife, and I, and our family, to avoid getting sick. Although I think I had it in the beginning, to tell you the truth. I got very sick, right after I came back from that last job.
It's not surprising.
But I had symptoms of just like a bad dry cough, you know. And after about 3 weeks, I have a very healthy immune system, you know, knock on wood, thank God. It's one of the things I think I got from my mother. But so I realized about 3 months, you know, I did the Mighty Max's Monday Memories,
right.
which was fun, and
yeah.
I was really, it was a lot of work to do behind the scenes,
of course.
I so enjoyed the questions that mm-hmm. people had.
Yeah.
It was really
they were great. They actually frustrated me how great they were when I went to think about what I wanted to ask, because I don't want to ask exactly the same questions. But there were so many great questions that were put out there.
Yeah,
so it was well thought out.
To tell you what I did, mm-hmm. basically, I have been working as a musician since I was 7 years old.
Right.
And I realized I have never, apart from all the other stuff I did that mm-hmm. outside of music, I never took a vacation, like just go someplace. I've been a lot of places,
right.
but it was always working. And I was, like the rest of us, was sort of forced inside. Thankfully, you know, I married above my station, so mm-hmm. My wife Becky's a, apart from being an incredible dancer.
A great, teacher.
And great blues harmonicist
yeah.
now,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
And she's a teacher
right.
at Shore Regional.
Right.
She's an incredible cook. She's at the chef category as mm-hmm. far as, so I ate great.
Right.
I basically did nothing but read, work out every day, and with a routine that, you know, keeps me strong.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized it was almost like, this must be what retirement is like. I never had that much free time
yeah.
to just do what I wanted to do. I was always working.
It must have felt strange in the middle of it in December to come to New York and do Saturday Night Live with the band when Letters to You came out. I would think. I know they had a lot of COVID protection.
Yeah,
when that was done.
Well, I have a good friend mm-hmm. who's the producer, the actual
well, sure.
on the floor producer
mm-hmm.
of that.
Right.
And I had, and when they stayed on the air,
right.
Even before, you know, Bruce asked us to do this. But I'll tell you a funny story about it. You know, he was telling me how safe it is. I didn't really have a problem because, you know, I was the beneficiary, as we all were, of Bruce's largesse in getting us there,
mm-hmm.
for one thing. And that was really pretty special. And it was, it was extremely controlled. But one of the funny things that happened was I got a text and from Bruce about, it was like 3 weeks before, right? I think it was December 12th mm-hmm. or 14th. You know, hey Max, we got a gig. and I wrote him back saying, Bruce, that, I know exactly, that's fantastic,
yeah.
but it makes me feel like I'm in eighth grade again, waiting to play the school dance 6 months from now. And he wrote back, he says, that's exactly it. I was like, wow, we got a gig where we're gonna play for people. And that's what the whole thing was like. You couldn't believe you were sort of out of your room and playing, and,
mm-hmm.
and for that, you know, brief moment. And Saturday Night Live it's hard to do.
Right.
A lot of rehearsals, mm-hmm. long hours, and you stay up late.
Right.
And then
you add all of the protection and everything else they threw in.
The protection
yeah.
was pretty unbelievable.
Yeah,
they had these
heard.
Hall monitors
right.
that wore purple vests with a double yardstick that
mm-hmm.
if you weren't standing 6 feet apart with the mask on, they would come over and push you apart. And you couldn't leave your room.
Right.
You know, they put you in a place and they sequester you. And I was completely comfortable. We had no, you know, vaccinations at that
right,
point.
Right.
And so it was fun. It was doable.
Yeah. And from a fan's position, to have something to look forward to that night was just incredible, because things were not great in December. And I know, I'm speaking on behalf, even though it's a financial show, on behalf of the E Street Nation, that was a lift. It was a lift that everybody needed.
Yeah, you know, it was, and I think that was the motivation. It
yeah.
was just, let's just,
no, it worked.
You know, for Bruce, just a gift to, you know, hey, we made $300 each.
Yeah.
And that was that was good too.
That
you know?
Too,
I mean,
sure.
You get your union wage.
Yeah.
And, you know, but I think that was it. It was just like to do something,
right.
you know.
And new music on top of it, you know, with the fantastic album that had come out. So,
yeah.
So I want to go way back to Beth Israel Hospital, which, by the way, I was born at too, in Newark, and many
you
of
looked
our
familiar.
Age. Yeah. You were there about 10 years before me, but my picture was on the wall. I'd love to talk about Newark a little bit, and then we'll get into Maplewood, South Orange. I mean, you described it on your Max show, the Philip Roth neighborhood. And as a grandfather who had a photo studio in that neighborhood, I have memories of it. But you know, when you watched the Plot Against America, for example, did you feel like this was it?
Yeah, completely. South Ward, you know, which is, for people who don't know, kind of borders Newark, that Newark Airport, Northern State Penitentiary, and it was the Jewish section of Newark, the Weequake section, they called it. And so sure, a big Philip Roth fan, always have been. As a matter of fact, my father's business was a summer camp in the Poconos.
Where my brother-in-law, Jerry, went with you one summer.
What's his last
name? Jerry Bedron.
Oh, remember, Jerry, you met him in my bunk. Right, Jerry exactly. Bedron, right. Yep. That was a different camp, but
yes.
So my father's, that was his business. Mm-hmm. And he started that in 1930 up in this one particular camp. And in 1952 and 1953, Philip Roth was a counselor at my father's camp. My mother taught at Weequake High School for like 50 years. I had a second cousin who was an English teacher there, who was actually older than Roth and inspired him and brought him back there to speak after he made it. But anyway, last year sometime, my management company got a letter from a woman who was mounting the quintessential Philip Roth exhibit at the Newark Museum.
Right.
And apparently someone had given a gift, or he had given a gift of all his books, which they have, but his letters. And in and among the letters was a letter home from camp to his parents.
And
he's talking about, it was a bit of that, yeah. He goes, and then finally there's a line, everything would be good if it wasn't for that Weinberg bastard. The letter, the woman who was mounting this, may I assume that was Max Weinberg? And so he sent me the letter, and I wrote her back saying, well, I would have been just about a year old, so I don't think it was me. But judging from the tone, I think it was my cousin Lewis, who was 14 at the time, and he was like an Eddie Haskell, Dennis the Menace kind of guy. But if you watch The Plot Against America, you know that it was all about, it's a phenomenal shorter book about the polio scare, and he goes away to camp.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was my father's camp that Philip Roth went to, but he went there in 52 and 53 as a counselor. He was 19. In the book and in the new biography, which unfortunately has been pulled from the shelves, but I got a copy of early on, he talks about wanting his girlfriend from Newark to come get a job there so they could be together the second summer. So he called the camp director.
Right.
Well, that was my father. Yeah. So it's in the Plot Against America book and TV series, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
And that's really what it was like. It was, we moved out.
How old were you when you moved out?
A year and a half, I think, something like that.
So
what happened was the house was so small, we moved to Maplewood.
Right, which is what every Jew in the South Ward did, basically. It was Maplewood and South Orange. There were towns that we were accepted. It's interesting because I live
South Orange, you had to have money.
Yeah, in a town that I live in now and some other friends know about. Not so accepted back in 1959, 1960, but you know, South Orange certainly and Maplewood were. But
the thing was that even though, so I basically, whenever this has come up, I said, well, I slept in Maplewood, but because everything my parents and my older sisters did was in Newark.
Right.
And Maplewood is right on the border.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, right there.
I never really, I had much more of a street life than a sort of ballpark, green, leafy thing, upbringing, which was good when I got into music.
Right. Well, in your first gig, were you 7 years old, a bar mitzvah, right?
Yeah. Well, it was a bar mitzvah or a wedding. I'm not quite sure.
What was the song?
Well, at 7 years old, I didn't know a lot of songs.
Okay, but you got up there and you played
something. My mother was a head counselor at camp. That's how my parents met.
Right.
And in 1936. And in, I was seven, so it would have been late 57, 58. And I was the only boy. So wherever we went out, to someplace like that. Right. I had a beautiful suit, you know, tab collar, tie. Right. I looked like a little man, right? She loved dressing me in these, you know, and they couldn't really afford it, but my son is going to look like a prince. That's a whole other story, but I was kind of a prince to my mother anyway.
Right.
And I was given, without going into the whole detail of how I became a drummer, I had the ability, and I was given a little beat-up drum by my cousin who played drums. He was quite a bit older than I, and he gave me this thing, and I would hack around on it. And my parents had a record of John Philip Sousa marches. And I listened to that, and I could play to that, right? So at this catered affair, which was in Milburn or Short Hills.
Probably the Short Hills caterers. Chanticleer.
The Chanticleer.
Yeah,
it was at the Chanticleer.
I had my bar mitzvah party at the Chanticleer.
You did?
Yeah, sing along with Mitch.
Oh, you were a rich kid then.
My father was working for a jazz record label then, so it was a good year.
Oh, it was a good year.
It happened to be a good year. Yeah.
Well,
they,
anyway,
they had George Benson.
My mother goes up to the band leader. His name was Herb Zane. Now, Herb Zane, at that time, was the sort of, you know, wedding bar mitzvah orchestra, combo, whatever you want. And she said, my son plays drums, can he play with your band? And he looked at me, this little kid, but I was really dressed sharp, you know. And he said, what do you play? I said, well, I can play, and I could, when the saints come marching in. Because I could do a little ding, 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 right? And I could do the march thing. And, you know, I was fearless.
Right.
So I go up there, and, you know, and I counted it off. I said, one, two, three, four, dun, 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 you know, go like that. And then they came in, dun, 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 dun. And I got through the song, because I would do a drum solo. I didn't, you know, when you're 7 years old, I was shy,
right?
But not behind the drums, ever. I was a very shy kid, but whenever I played the drums, I sort of like, you could show off.
Right.
And so he hired me as a little novelty act to go along with his regular orchestra, and I'd come in, I'd dress up, he'd give me, you know, 50 cents. I played with him till I was 14, off and on. And, you know, but the whole concept of drumming for me was, unlike a lot of people I know and many of my colleagues, was absolutely not a way to rebel.
Right.
I wanted into the establishment because of my parents' financial situation with the camp, which ended up in Chapter 11 in 1965. You know, I had to go out and work. So for me, playing the drums and getting gigs, particularly in and around Newark, was a way I could bring money in. And so
you were helping the family.
I was helping my family, and you know, it was better than a paper route to me or working in the supermarket.
Right.
And, you know, and working with Herb Zane was great because it really gave me experience in everything but rock and roll. It was still the transition between, you know, the club dates where it was all rock.
Right.
It was still sort of the swing, standards, cha-cha, merengue, bossa nova, all the sort of what they used to call legitimate drumming. And I was very well versed in that.
Right.
And I got better at it. And then, of course, you know, with the Beatles, I'd already been playing for 6 or 7 years.
Well,
the
Beatles happened. Did you see DJ Fontana first before the Beatles? Was the experience earlier
much.
That really influenced you? Yeah.
Well, I saw the first time I saw Elvis with DJ Fontana and Bill Black and Scotty Moore, I had two teenage sisters. And my oldest sister was, they were, I always describe them as, think of the movie Grease. One was Rizzo, my oldest sister.
Right.
One was Sandy, my surviving older sister.
Right.
And, you know, so it was rock and roll and classical music, you know, pop music and opera in our house. So the Dorsey brothers, Tommy and Jimmy Dorsey, had a summer replacement show. I think it was on CBS, and Elvis was on there, and that was the first, that was a year before Ed Sullivan. So saw him, made an impression on me. The, what really made the impression on me was when he was on Milton Berle, which was April, I think, of 56. And, because now I kind of knew who he was, my sister, my older sister, Patty, you know, poodle skirt, ponytail, the whole leather jacket. You know, dressed me up as Elvis with cardboard sideburns, made me a little rubber band guitar, And
I know you have photos of everything. There
I do.
Has to be photos
yes,
of
I
that
actually
somewhere,
do.
Max. Okay.
That I don't know if I have the rubber band guitar, but I do have a lot of stuff like that. But I went past Elvis to DJ because of that, and I've said it a million times, that drum roll and Hound Dog, you know?
Right.
And I had the little drums, so sort of things started to open up and make a little bit of sense. And I was not a great, I loved playing sports, but I wasn't really that good. Plus, both my parents were phenomenal athletes. My father lettered in 5 different sports, and they would never let me play anything where I could get hurt, right? And which really upset me at the time, but now at the age of 70, I am so glad.
Yeah. You know, you got knees.
Drumming hurt me through the years, but,
well, sure.
You know, my knees are good.
Right.
I never broke my nose, and, you know, playing sports.
Yeah.
Yeah, it would all kind of came together, and I, but for me, yeah, I'd been, it was DJ, really. It was, everybody paid attention to the drummer when Elvis, you know, well, at least I did.
Right.
And it made a big noise. And I had the drum, and I had these beat-up sticks, the sticks I still have. And it just, I kind of fell into it, and plus I couldn't, you know, go out for teams and things, so it, and then the great transition was there was that weird period between Elvis and the Beatles,
right,
where he, you know, in 58 he went into the army,
right,
and everything kind of fell apart, and you had, you know, Frankie Avalon and Fabian and the pop stars based on Elvis,
right,
and that music I like too, because whether the songs, some people say the songs were corny, but the rhythm sections on all of those records were, and I found out later who they were, the guys. The rhythm
was Hal Blaine involved in any of that work?
Well, on the West Coast.
On the West Coast, yeah. I didn't think he did
not so
Four
much
Seasons
in the 50s.
Or Frankie Valli.
No, that was two guys, Buddy Salzman for the Four Seasons and all that stuff. And I studied with him. Buddy Salzman and it'll come to me.
That's all right.
See, that's
all right.
Age, man.
That's it. That's
all right. They did all the records. You know, they were the basically... And they were jazzers.
Right.
You know, Gary Chester was the other one. And they were jazzers in the 40s. They all wanted to be Gene Krupa.
Right. When you love Buddy Rich. I mean, that was such an influence.
Buddy was a dear, dear friend
was your,
of mine.
Was your dad playing Buddy Rich records?
No, I mean, God, no.
No?
No. No, we had, like I said.
So you found him on your own?
Well, actually later. You know, I had the same corny records that, you know, everybody did. The one advantage I had was I started to wear glasses really early, like 4 years old. And my optician was on the second floor of this, you know, sort of industrial building on Broad Street in Newark. And it was kind of a scary place in those days. And I had the big Buddy Holly glasses, thick lenses, never had good eyes. And the only redeeming factor of this building was on the first floor was a rack jobber, which some people will remember that term. A rack jobber was the guy who would take 45s and set them up in Woolworths in the racks. And it was sort of a record distributor. And so my reward every time I went there was he would give me a handful of cutouts, records with a hole in it because they were being sent back or something. So I got some really interesting 45s.
I'm sure you do.
Plus, I always loved, my mother was a Broadway musical fanatic.
That's
I feel like I'm
go.
Dominating the conversation.
No, but that's
but
where
you're
I'm but that's where I'm going, and you know, I'm glad you mentioned your mother because I did have the opportunity to spend some time with her at one of the JCC events that I was involved with you years ago in New Jersey, and my wife and I spent some time sitting in the back room and talking a lot about you know, the village and the town hall and all the great sandwiches we could find, but You're going to all these Broadway shows. You get the experience that's amazing, which I was fortunate to see, you know, incredible shows that were happening. But how does a nice Jewish boy wind up playing drums in the pit for a Broadway hit show based on the Gospel of Matthew?
Oh, Godspell.
And the Passion of Christ. I think it was kind of all combined. You know?
Well, it was a hit show.
Yeah.
It was a big show on Broadway.
Well, Canada, didn't it start in Canada, I think?
Yeah. It was written by, that's how I met Paul Schaefer.
Right.
He came down to take the piano player's place when I was doing the show. We did it for about 8 months, both of us.
By the way, written by Stephen Schwartz.
Stephen
who did
Schwartz.
Pippin and Wicked, so, you
right.
know.
And it was a big, you know, they had Day by Day, it was a big
right,
record.
Right.
So I was at the time going to Seton Hall University.
Mm-hmm.
I was living home.
Right.
I was taking drum lessons with Bernard Purdy. Drum lessons with Pretty Purdy consisted basically of picking up his laundry, doing errands, and then occasionally he would give you some, you know, I didn't realize at the time, but I was an apprentice.
Mm-hmm.
So because of him, I got to help him set his drums up for Aretha, which became the album Aretha, live at the Fillmore West. But
wow.
They did two shows at the Apollo to warm that up. And Ray Charles wasn't at the Apollo, but everybody else was, you know, the King Curtis
band. So you were setting up the drums at the Apollo?
Yeah, I was this little white kid, you know, with, you know, Cornell Dupree.
Yeah.
Seldon Powell, the A musicians who played on all of the records, you know, back in the 60s.
That had to feel crazy when you, I don't know, 45 years later, you're playing the Apollo with Bruce for the beginning of Wrecking Ball Tour, I think.
Well, that was pretty that was exceptional.
Yeah,
that
yeah,
we
yeah.
did a debut show there.
Right,
and,
yeah.
Or that
live
tour.
On Sirius.
That was very,
yeah.
very exciting.
Oh, what an incredible.
You know, and you know, 25, 30 years later, maybe more than that, it was quite different.
Yeah.
The whole area was quite different, you know, quite gentrified compared to when I went
sure.
up there with Purdy.
Right.
But I was with Purdy, and it was sort of like, and he owned it, you know, particularly at that time. I mean, he played on everybody's records. He took me to the session for that song Daydreaming.
Mm-hmm.
Daydreaming, I'm thinking.
Yeah.
I was at that session.
Wow.
And, you know, Cornell Dupree and Chuck Rainey.
Mm-hmm.
It was such an education. I was 19.
Mm.
So I'd happily carry his laundry and go shopping for him.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, hopefully at the time, and in fact, he was my main credit. What have you done? Well, I studied with Bernard Purdy.
Mm-hmm.
I hadn't done anything. Godspell,
right.
a friend of mine, who was a recording engineer, had another friend who played bass in the show, and they were looking for another alternate drummer. On Broadway, when you get the show, if you're the primary drummer, after 13 weeks, if it lasts, it's your gig. Then you can farm it out.
Mm-hmm.
And you get paid your salary, but then you pay the sub and out of that. And so I became a sub, and then the primary drummer left. And about a year before I met Bruce,
mm-hmm.
I became the main drummer.
Was Gilda Radner and Martin Short in the show then? Because
no,
I know they got their starts too in Godspell, I think.
In Godspell in Canada.
In Canada, oh, okay.
They did comedy. I'll tell you, there were some people, a TV director named Don Scardino was in it. Another guy who, you know, one of these guys, you don't know his name, but you see his face on
right.
a million TV shows, Paul Kreppel. There was another guy, his name was William, who, you know, I gave my 2 weeks notice.
Mm-hmm.
And he came up, he said, you know, I think you're really making a big mistake. This show could last forever. You
yeah.
know? I said, well, this guy's really good. And the band he's got is really good. So
let's just wind you know. That back a little bit. So you're in Godspell, you pick up a Village Voice. And
well, no, I was in Godspell. I was playing yeah. in a band with yeah. several friends of mine, and we were kind of doing Traffic, Tull, sort of progressive rock a little
right.
bit. You know, we were very good jammers in those days. Now, this is, you know, early 70s, and you know, I'm a drummer, so I was playing with so many different, you know, it's like we were talking about goalies before.
Mm-hmm.
It's like being a goalie. You right. always need a goalie.
Right.
You always need a drummer. And, you know, it's the drummer in those days. Everybody wanted to be Tony Williams or Billy Cobham, so it's the drummer playing, you know, 25 choruses of everybody else soloing. And it really built up my chops.
Mm-hmm.
So the band I was in, Bruce's, so it was based in and around Nanuet, New York. And 914 Studios was on Route 303 in Nanuet.
Mm-hmm.
Which was, it was an old gas station, and that's where Greetings from Asbury Park and the
Wild and the Innocent,
Wild and the Innocent
all done
was
there,
recorded.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so the guys I was playing with lived, they were from up there, they lived up there, and they knew Louis LaHave, and
mm-hmm.
you know, they knew, they didn't know Bruce, but they knew that Bruce Springsteen, Janis Ian was the main person who used that studio, and she was produced by Brooks Arthur, who owned it, who was of course a legendary early engineer, and then became
mm-hmm.
a producer. In any case, the singer went down to the bottom line in 74 and came back raving about this guy, Bruce Springsteen, and his band, the E Street Band. And 4 months before that, I was going to Seton Hall. I was asked to play drums in a, there was a friend of mine in the, going to school with me, Jim Marino, is from Belmar, New Jersey. And he was kind of the singer-songwriter, Jim Croce, James Taylor. Mm-hmm. And he had a group of friends that they'd harmonized together. And he got the gig to open for Bruce in the Seton Hall cafeteria. It was April of 74. Asked me if I'd play drums, because they didn't typically have a drummer. And I said, sure, because I lived three blocks away. And so I never heard of Bruce Springsteen. And you know, we rehearsed for a couple of weeks for this thing. It was a big deal gig. He was a big fan. And in his set, he didn't play it that night. I learned later he played the song Sandy. He didn't play it that night because, you know, Bruce was going to play it, right?
Right.
And he did it acoustic anyway. So the odd thing that happened was in the middle of our set, I started to get really ill. And I felt really bad. It turns out I had a acute tonsillitis. They took out my tonsils the next day. So I was going to leave. And Jim said to me, oh, you got to listen to this guy. It'll blow your mind. I said, I really don't feel good. He said, well, listen to one song. So I said, all right, I'm going to listen to one song. So we're in the back, and it's in the cafeteria. The stage is like tables, you know. The, and no introduction, just the lights come down, light hits the piano, and guy sits down at the piano and starts playing. And real long, this long introduction, and that guy was David Sanchez.
Right.
And he's playing this very extended intro to New York City's Serenade, and about 3 or 4 minutes into it, I said, I really gotta go.
Yeah.
And I went home, and I did go to the hospital. So when I left there thinking that, you know, Bruce Springsteen was this black cat who played piano and he was fantastic, you know. I had no idea.
That's like a 6 minute intro.
Yeah, I mean, and you know, I left before the band came on. I didn't know anything about Bruce Springsteen. And it wasn't called any, I don't think it was billed with the E Street Band there. Some of the first shows I did were not billed in the E Street Band. And then shortly after Roy and I joined, it became and the E Street Band. So, the next I heard that name was this guy came back from the bottom line and said, this guy, this is really where rock is going. And we were playing sort of, you know, the a lot of traffic, you know, rock and roll stew and very, you know, more progressive stuff, which I thought, and that's what was popular. And I said, gee, that Springsteen, that was that guy that, you know, Jim Marino opened for. And Joe D'Elia, who's still one of my dear friends and is an incredible pianist and composer who put the whole Buster Poindexter thing together. He was the pianist in that and musical director. He auditioned on piano. I didn't know it. Then we had two keyboards. The other guy, this guy Jack Kraft, he auditioned on piano. Now, he was really good friends with Louis, the engineer. And I think they both kind of thought they'd get it, you know, it's rock and roll.
Right.
Rock and roll at the time was the kind of rock and roll we ended up, you know, Bruce was doing, nobody was doing that. I mean, it was heavy, it was Zeppelin, Slade, you know, definitely wasn't.
No.
And I had kind of fallen out I loved Zeppelin, but I didn't see myself playing that.
Right.
And I still had an interest to go to law school, and I was still in college. And so about 3 weeks after that ad came out, and these two guys auditioned, Joe, he brought the ad, and he said, you know, I heard from Louis, the engineer, they're still looking for a drummer. So I figured to myself, well, it seems like everybody in this band is auditioning, I'll throw my hand. I didn't know who he was.
Right.
And I didn't know any of his songs. I knew that Jim Marino was from the Shore, that he was a big fan, and he had played a little bit with Clarence, who I didn't know. In any case, so I called up, you know, I remember the number was 212-759-1610. It was Mike Capel's office. He had an assistant there, his name was Don, and he wasn't in, they called me back. I was living in the basement. It wasn't an apartment, I was literally living in the basement of Joe D'Elia's father-in-law's house on an army cot, and splitting my time between, I basically take my laundry back to my parents' mm-hmm. house, and, you know, because they were in South Orange, right. Napewood, and this was up in Nyack, New York, and was trying to break away from home. And so he took a message, and he was a physicist, and he had this yellow legal pad, and he wrote, it was all these equations, and at the bottom it said, Max, this guy Don Nada from Spring Stein, S-T-E-I-N, called something about an audition. I have that piece of paper, by the way. It's in my memorabilia. So I, you know, I went down there on a Monday night for, you know, which was a dark night on Broadway. So I only brought a bass drum, a snare drum, and a hi-hat. I didn't bring a whole drum set because the ad said no junior ginger bakers.
Oh, okay.
And that to me was very revealing mm-hmm. because I wasn't a ginger baker. There
right.
was one ginger baker. Right. He was phenomenal.
Right. One band Cream, and that was it.
Well, yeah, and he was a great drummer. I mean, yeah. people don't know what a great jazz drummer he was in England before Cream.
That's true.
I mean, he was a serious jazz right. drummer, and he was in direct line with Phil Seaman, who was, you know, the, you know, most famous sort of jazz Dixieland swing guy, who was 10 years older than Ginger. That's too deep.
Yeah. Oh, you could find the big beat somewhere.
Max's probably
book,
on
which
eBay.
Gives you, yeah, which gives you all the details on that.
So what that said to me, that ad, no mm-hmm. junior Ginger Bay, was a little sarcastic way of saying, you know, no drum solos. Mm-hmm. And it said Bruce Springsteen and the E Street Band on Columbia Records, the ad. So, all right, I'd heard this name a couple of times. He had a record deal, which in the end, that was, you know, the nirvana. It didn't even matter if you sold records, which he didn't. You had a deal.
Right.
And in fact, I think they had sold, when I joined the band, a total of about 15,000 records of both albums. He was about to be dropped mm-hmm. from, which I didn't know, and I didn't care, because I brought this little drum set, and at the time, you remember, and it's still, I look at my son Jay's mm-hmm. drums, he's got, and he uses all of them. You know, he's got lots of toms, lots of cymbals, timpani, uses it all. But in those days, if you had that kind of drum set, that meant you were a Ginger Baker type drummer.
Right.
So I came in with this, what turned to be this minimalist drum set, which it was simply convenience. I mm-hmm. didn't want to take the whole, you know, all my drums down. And it said Chuck Berry, Jerry Lee Lewis. I didn't really need any tom-toms. You know, because everything they did was on the snare
right.
drum and the
exactly.
hi-hat and, you know, and the bass drum. So. To me, it was pretty obvious. So, but apparently, it made a big minimalist. Oh, this guy must think he's really good. He doesn't even bring an entire drum set. And it was just that I had to carry it. And I mm-hmm. said, well, I could cut this. So, you know, that was the first night I auditioned. And I had no expectations at all. And I think one of the things that won Bruce over, well, I know 20 years later, I asked him why he picked me. But one of the things that won him over was that I said I was from New Jersey, when in those days it was very popular if you were from the tri-state area, if you were a musician, to say you were from New York. You know, there were New York musicians, LA musicians,
right.
and Nashville was like Mars.
Right.
And that was it. So, you know, wherever you were from New York. But I said, no, I'm from New Jersey. And I didn't really know that New Jersey played such a big role in, you know, in his life and
right,
music. I didn't
right.
know him at all. And he said, do you know any of my songs during that first, you know? No, because I hadn't, you know. I said, can you give me some names? Reeled off a few. And then the fourth or fifth song he said was Sandy.
Mm-hmm.
I said, yeah, I think I played that song. Jim Marino played that song. Mm. So, and I was a very good improviser.
Wow.
I could pick up really, that's why I got in the band. I could pick up quickly, and
very appropriate as we're sitting here in Danny Clinch's gallery in Asbury Park. So
yeah,
perfect song,
Sandy.
Yeah.
Exactly, and I, you know, I kind of knew it, and I said, you know, I remember thinking, well, when I got in the band, the first thing I changed was the beat jumped around. All it was very quaint. It was great, and Vinny was terrific, but to me, it should be more linear. So it went from halftime to straight time and back and. So I just made everything in four, mm-hmm. not, you know, with the apart.
Right.
But I just straightened it out a little bit. So it was sort of the first, may have been one of three suggestions I've made in the last 48 years, but it was a good suggestion.
It was a good suggestion. So
yeah, so I got, you know, got in the band. And
Roy got in same time, right? Right before you, right?
Roy got in. So I, my second audition, my first audition, it was just Bruce, Clarence, Danny, and Gary. Mm-hmm. And what was most impressive, actually, was not, but Bruce was quite impressive right from the you know, the jump with Counting It Off. But what was really impressive was the way the other guys, the other three guys, focused on what he was doing. And that was the thing that almost more impressed me, because that was the hardest thing to get in a band, for everybody to sort of push in one direction, right? So immediately, the first thing it said to me was, oh, I get it. This isn't a band. This is a guy with a band. This is before I got in the band. Mm-hmm. Because they're just catching everything. And so I did well, apparently, and he told me, you know, years later, every drummer got a half hour.
And 60 drummers, right?
64 or 5.
64 drummers.
I think I was around the 58th. And he was looking for a particular thing.
Right.
Like, you know.
Which
I mean, that was
is.
A bespoke band.
Yeah.
In many ways.
Right.
He said, everybody, no matter how bad or good you were, if you were good in an area he didn't particularly think was helpful to him, didn't matter. But everybody got a half hour. And during the half hour, they played this, one of their big showstoppers was Let the Four Winds Blow. And he kind of straightened it out a little bit, because there were a lot of sort of kiddies back accents. Mm-hmm. Which was no problem for me, because I was used to doing that kind of stuff. But some guys, you know, played with their eyes closed. If you played with your eyes closed,
yeah,
you didn't make through the audition. And in the one song, he did this with every drummer. He said he got to the middle and was really pumping, and he went like this, like stop. And if you didn't stop, he did it again. And he said, you know, the second time or the third time, most people got it, you know, stop, because they heard the band stop.
Right.
And the drummer kept playing, right? And he did it like twice. So with me, you know, boom, somebody goes like that. Like with my background, if a dancer kicks, you hit a cymbal. You know, to accent it. It's sort of like drums in service of some physical thing. Just came very naturally to me. It goes back to that legitimate drumming rather than just, I'm a rock drummer, I'm a jazz mm-hmm. drummer. You can play a little bit of everything. That's how you stay in work as a drummer.
Right.
You know, I didn't write, so I'm not a writer. And, so then he stopped, okay, so they're stopped, and he'd get a long pause. And then without warning, he shot out his hand like that. And out of the 60-something drummers that played that with him over a period of about 6 weeks, I was the only one who hit a rim shot when he went like that. And that's when he said to me, that's when I decided you were the guy, because you went for it. You know, you didn't know me
right
at all. You didn't know anybody, and you didn't know the music. Although you were very quick, it wasn't. He said some guys came in and they had both albums down, which is not what he wanted.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, to me it was not. I had just one of the side things I did was about 5 months before that. I auditioned and got the gig for this duo on Columbia, ironically, called Janie and Dennis. They were husband and wife singer-songwriters. And there was a lot of expectation for them, and they had auditions. I get in the band. About 3 weeks later, they say, it's really not working out. So they kind of fired me, and I was really bummed out.
Yeah, and we all remember all the Janie and Dennis wonderful albums and the Grammys, the Irving Thalberg, or maybe that's the Oscars.
Remember that?
Yeah.
So that was February of 74, and I was really bummed out. So I took a leave of absence from Godspell, and I drove out to the West Coast. I drove somebody's car to try to find some work, right? In those days, you could, Akon Auto Transport, you mm-hmm. could drive somebody's car.
Right.
That's a whole other story we don't have time for. But I get out there, I come back, I'm a little refreshed, and you know, it was that August that I met Bruce, and we started this band High Point in June. And you know, we would play the Orangeburg Pub, which is probably still there, down the highway from Studio 914, and it was at the Orangeburg Pub. I had a gig when I got the phone call that, you know, Bruce wanted me to join the band.
Mm.
And
now, did you go right into the sessions? Because this is 74, so almost time to He's already working on Born to Run, I guess.
He had recorded Born to Run.
Well, Born to Run, he had already recorded the song. Right?
Yeah, that was done.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Right.
Somebody recently said, yeah, I loved your playing on Born to Run. Right. And I, for 40-something, 8 years, I've been saying, it's not me.
Well, it is on every other song on this album.
Yeah, on the album,
just
right.
Not that one particular song, but...
Well, Boone Carter, who I'm sure still is, but...
Yeah.
Excuse me, at the time, incredible drummer.
Right.
I mean, really
right.
Good. He could do it all. Had great feel, too. When we came out with the box set a couple of years ago, he did a very funny interview, and guy asked him, you know, you're in 7-Eleven, you hear Born to Run, come on, what do you feel like doing? He goes, well, you know, I quit the band. I feel like running out into traffic. I thought that was a great response, but...
So what's the first time that you know, Born to Run's out, you're touring, of course, all over the place, the famous Harvard show, the Landau quote, the everything that went on there, but what's the first time you heard yourself on the radio? That had to be just like a magical moment. And knowing you, Max, you probably remember the song and where it happened.
With Bruce?
Yeah.
Well, I do, actually. and I was, it sounds like it's right out of a Springsteen song. We were playing in near Santa Barbara, and we were staying at this hotel. It was kind of on the beach in Santa Barbara, and Born to Run had just come out, and he had a rented station wagon, and we were he and I were going out to like a Denny's to get something to eat, whatever the equivalent was in Santa Barbara. And Jungle Land came on. It was a beautiful night. We pulled off the road and sat there in the darkness with, it was like a Springsteen song with just the glow of the radio.
Wow.
Listening to Jungle Land. So that was the first time, an instance where I heard myself play, you know, a Bruce song on the radio. I had done a couple of other recordings before that with my high school bands and another band that I joined after high school, and I heard them on the radio. And so that was exciting.
Oh.
But, the Columbia was still very much up in the air about whether they were going to keep him.
Right.
And it was a thrill. And we sat there, and you know, it was a long song.
Right.
We were both hungry.
Yeah.
We were going out to eat,
that's
right?
True.
But,
that's
like,
true.
Time stood still.
Yeah.
I vividly, well, I have a good memory generally, but.
It's probably a 24-hour restaurant, so.
It was one of those, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so we did eventually go out.
Right.
And, the one thing I remember about those kind of late night meals was Bruce himself would never want to order a whole milkshake, but can I have a sip of that? chocolate milkshake. So those were wonderful formative years, obviously, long time ago.
Sure.
But it was a thrill. Oh. And actually, I still get a thrill, you know. And sometimes, you know, you'll hear the music, any musician probably feels this, but you're very critical when you first hear something. And then it starts to open up. Your ears start to... I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Your ears start to take it in, and suddenly you disappear. Maybe not so suddenly, but, you know, you disappear, and the totality of the thing hits you. And maybe what you didn't like 10 years ago now hits your ears in a different way. So,
and now you've got East Street Radio playing, you know, every one of your songs 24 hours a day, you know, so you have the opportunity to hear, you know, the night Backstreets in Milan to, Candy's Room in Stockholm or wherever. So it's always playing.
Yeah, well, you mentioned Stockholm. It's funny. We have a song that we don't play very often called Back in Your Arms.
Right. Love that song.
And actually, Jimmy Vivino from the TV band plays bass on it.
Right.
On the album.
Mm-hmm.
Because Gary didn't make the session for some reason. He got snowed in. And, we're looking around New York for a bass player. And I had just come over from NBC, and I knew Jimmy was probably still there. I called him, and he came over, and he played bass. But we don't often play it. And on the River 2.0 tour, we played it a couple of times.
Sure.
And after the show, we were going to the next gig, and we were, you know, sort of standing around talking. And, it really sounded good. You know, congratulating. Mm-hmm. It was good, you know, it was good tonight. And Bruce said, the best time we ever played that, though, the best it ever sounded was Stockholm in 2009. And then I realized and said, Bruce, that was Jay. That wasn't me. And it was,
yeah.
And it's a, and it, it was like, yeah, he kicked your ass on that one, Max. And of course, he kicks my ass on several of the tunes. Radio Nowhere is one.
I remember the Radio Nowhere opening the show. I think it was still Giant Stadium when Jay joined the band.
Well, the funny thing about that, so when we were rehearsing to play the Super Bowl in 2009, we were rehearsing in New York, and Bruce came in with a scratch pad with about 200 songs on it for Jay to learn. He told me he could start working on these because, mm-hmm. you know, I was doing the Tonight Show and we had a scheduling thing. And, you know, he asked Jay to play, which he did, and he did marvelously. And Back in Your Arms was not on that list. So Jay was, you know, going to high, he was in high school, and he'd come home and he'd, you know, practice the parts, and he'd, because he learned how to play, like all of us,
right.
by playing the records.
Right.
In his case, you know, Metallica, Slipknot,
right.
punk, you know, and I took him to, it was a great bonding, all through his, from the age of 13 till he graduated high school, three shows a week we went to.
Mm-hmm.
I'd get done with the TV show and just, you know, we'd go to a show, and as he says, this is my father, the pass.
Yeah.
So we saw everybody. And
a lot that, of a lot of earplugs for you during those metal shows, those 6 years?
No, because I'd always learn something.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd see, you know, whether it's Travis Barker
right.
or...
That's true. Tremendous, you know, amount of talent.
Coheed and Cambria's yeah. Thomas Pridgen.
Right.
Incredible young drummers. So for me, it was, you know, to me, it was all rock and roll. And
yeah.
it was, you know, Jay's music, not mine, which I would have never listened to, but he's very analytical, and we spent a lot of time going to not only shows, you know, I had the opportunity to take him to some of the living legend jazz drummers like Roy Haynes,
mm-hmm.
you know, who's still playing and he's almost 100 years old, just so he could, you know, develop his ears. But you know, he was Jay was, you know, practicing. He was getting all the stuff down, and he said, you know, this is like, he had to absorb the history of the kind of music that influenced us. And he'd always sort of heard it around the house. But I said, Jay, look, here's my copy of Sam and Dave's Greatest Hits. If you internalize this, it'll teach you everything you know, you need to know about playing with Bruce and the E Street Band.
So true.
And because he knew the Beatles, mm-hmm. all of my little Ringo-isms and Charlie Watts. He knew all mm-hmm. that vocabulary.
Yeah.
And he threw in some of his metal mm-hmm. stuff, you know. And he's like a rocket scientist. He's got a degree from Stevens Institute
right.
In Hoboken. So he figured it out. It was hard. But so they're in Stockholm.
Mm-hmm.
And Bruce calls out Back in Your Arms. Jay's never played the song. He never heard of the song. Gets this panicked look on his face. And he looks over at Steve, who's kind of, you know, can be the music director on stage.
Right.
And Steve mouths to him, Sam and Dave, which mm. it's like.
So Steve,
and there's
perfect.
A recording of that, and yeah. damn, he hit every accent.
Yeah.
Bring it down, pow. Boom. And there's a recording, and Bruce.
Yeah, the recording's incredible.
You know.
Sorry, I thought it was you.
Well, he played it better than me. And yeah. and it's a, you know, it's not an easy song to play because of the groove. And he nailed it, and he got a huge introduction, you know. So needless to say, I'm very proud of both my children
yeah.
who followed their instincts and developed careers.
And while we're talking about both kids, obviously Jay, we talked about, who's in Slipknot and also won Metal Drummer of the Year Award. I think he's got a Grammy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He won Best Metal Drummer 2 years in a row, Modern Drummer, which is like, you know, the industry magazine for drummers. But last year, 2 years ago in 2020, he won Best Rock Drummer, which is all of rock.
Wow.
I never even got close to that. So you always want your children to do better than you.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? I couldn't agree more. Speaking of children, you have an incredible daughter.
My daughter's
okay.
Book. Yeah.
I had the pleasure of interviewing Allie Rogan, Max's daughter, a fantastic journalist. You can go back and listen to that episode and you'll hear all about her journalism background. She's at NPR now, I believe, or
she is
PBS.
Senior producer at PBS NewsHour.
Right.
PBS NewsHour.
Right.
And she does a lot of foreign affairs. Right. And wrote this great book on her experiences with breast cancer.
Right, and Beat Breast Cancer Like a Boss, which is just a great title, obviously. But you had the opportunity to interview 30 powerful women that went through this, that had the BRCA gene, which, you know, ran in your family.
It's got from me.
Yeah.
We believe.
Right.
And we just did this past weekend, we did a co-interview for the CBS morning show, which I think is going to be on this Friday. Probably after this airs, before this airs, but about her experiences and mine,
right?
And trying to get, you know, the information out there and the stuff that we learned about the experience with both the BRCA gene, in my case, having prostate cancer, and dealing with that. Mm-hmm. And it's a wonderful book.
Yeah.
So there, Jay is in Los Angeles recording another Slipknot record.
Well,
they're going on tour. And, yeah. So, you know,
but Allie,
this is all for them to support me.
Allie also sings. I mean, I just saw Allie and Kristen Chenoweth do a duet.
Yeah.
And that was, I had to look three times. I'm like, wait, that's Allie. That's Allie Rogan.
Yeah. She's always been a great singer.
Voice.
Perfect pitch. And one of our games when she was a little girl was I guessed the singer.
Mm-hmm.
And she never failed.
Yeah.
And to guess who it was, whether it was Bono or Frank Sinatra or Paul McCartney, but she clearly has perfect pitch and never wanted to be a professional musician. Always wanted to be a journalist.
Right.
She's a wonderful pianist as well, and she does it for fun. She's in a band. She's also on a girls' hockey team.
Right.
So and married.
Right.
And her husband's a Washington Post columnist.
Yeah, great columnist.
He is.
Terrific.
And he has a great book out about China.
Right.
So, you know, like I said, they're following their dreams and they're able to.
But Father's Day coming up this weekend. This will air after Father's Day. It's certainly a lot of pride.
Nachas, as they say.
Yes, exactly.
Around the South Ward.
Yeah. Well, exactly. So. I wanted to just circle back for a minute because you hit on it earlier, how immediately you picked up this, you know, and all the moves that Bruce did. And you quoted this somewhere, it might have been on your Max Mondays, but it was just too good to not bring up, and that Bruce sets the tempo and your job is to hold it.
Yeah.
Just expand on that a little bit, because that, I think that in many ways defines the magic of the E Street Band right there.
Well, he's the band leader, and and he's the vocalist,
right.
And he knows from night to night where he wants to put it, let's say, and he's very good with that. The drummer's job is to provide the architecture to whether it's a song. In my case, my specialty is 3-minute rock songs, you know, or the jamming comes in handy when I was playing the old style, like Kitty's Back,
right.
And, you know, the more extended
E-Street
sort
Shuffle.
Of, you know, more classically oriented stuff,
right.
Long sections. But yeah, it's my job to provide, I liken it to being the white line, you know, down the middle of the road. And in any band, I mean, you know, it's not about metronomic time, it's about making it feel good and keeping it within certain limits. And, you know, the one thing I do know how to do is to play Bruce Springsteen's songs. And I had a very interesting experience two years ago, the summer of 18. He invited me up to put drums on what became like 40-something songs. And he was hardly there. He was there a little bit, but I worked with Ron Anello, his producer.
Right.
On replacing drum machines, in some cases other drummers. And it was fascinating because Ron got me out of, you know, being the, you know, the way I typically play on Bruce songs, which is what Bruce wants,
right.
Obviously, and the bigger, you know, more bombastic drumming.
Right.
And that was very interesting because it was a bit of a challenge, and I love a challenge. So. You know, to play something outside my bag, so to speak.
Yeah. Well, and Bruce just announced on radio the other day that something special's coming with a lot of different music. So I'm hoping some of those songs will. Be
oh,
part of
it
that.
Probably is. I mean, I did all sorts
right.
of
a lot of unreleased songs.
Oh, I did this. There's this rockabilly record he did apparently that.
Wow.
You know, I think he did it with a Lynn drum machine.
Did he have Gary Talon on it? I know Gary loves rockabilly. I remember seeing
the
show
who's
down,
on
the,
it,
down
but
the street
did,
at the Stone Pony.
He said, wow, this needs the Mighty Max touch, you know, and then he walked out. And so I did a bunch of, I don't know what's coming out, but it's above my pay grade. But I did a lot of songs in a lot of different styles. And he's always, I mean, that's his job. He goes over in there and records. Mm-hmm. Goes to a studio and he makes records. He doesn't know if he makes records. Mm-hmm. He records
he
the songs.
He just records songs.
See if they turn into a record.
Right. What about rituals? I mean, here we are at Danny's gallery, and I know this is a podcast, but for any of the people that get to see video of this, behind me is a wonderful picture that Danny Clinch took with you, your hands,
knee, my hands in ice.
All in ice. And I believe, we talked to Danny earlier, that was taken during the Rising rehearsals around the corner from here at the Paramount Theater. But listen, I spent a lot of time, I don't know if I saw maybe 35 shows on that last tour, and many of them, I don't know how I survived the 4 hours, and I would look at you and I would think, my God, how do you do it?
Well, I'm built
You don't
for
get
it.
A break.
No, you don't get a break.
The drummer doesn't get a break. I mean,
well, this drummer doesn't.
Yeah.
Some drummers
right.
do.
Right. This. Yeah. Exactly.
You know, I can be honest with you. Yeah. You know, you do 100 shows, you wait for those acoustic rendition songs.
Yeah. Maybe it's time to play Nebraska, Bruce. The whole album.
It really comes down to willpower.
Yeah.
And staying in shape. I mean, obviously staying in shape.
Exactly.
And, you know, you have to stay in shape, and it's willpower and. I know physically my body just physically mm-hmm. is adapted to that kind of stress. I'm not quite, I guess that's how I earned my nickname, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is I have to be able to play longer than him because he can decide when to stop.
Right.
I can't. So, and he's got tremendous strength, discipline, willpower, lung power. And, you know, it's really remarkable. It's mm-hmm. been, for all of us in the E Street Band, it's not just, you know, whatever the sort of things you might think were the gains from it, but the life lessons are invaluable and many from being in that experience with all the guys. I mean, with life lessons from everyone.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, particularly with Bruce, because you see, how hard he worked, and particularly in the beginning when it was mostly chaotic most of the time, how he fought against forces that were literally trying to destroy him. And I don't mean external forces like the business side of the music business, the racial side of the mm-hmm. music business, which unfortunately, as we all know, still continues to this day, but in the 70s was even more prevalent. A lot of pressure to do it his way. And drummers are often sitting back and watching the other guys figuring out the chords or writing the music, you know.
And I was an observer too. Sure.
And learned a lot.
And in the studio, in the great Tom Zimney films that he's done, including the recent Letters to You film, watching the core, I guess, I don't know, and this is not an insult to anyone else in the band, but you know, watching you and Gary and Roy and Steven learn Bruce's songs that quickly. I mean, that's the real deal, that you guys put that record together in, you know, a week.
The Letter to You.
And there's some tough songs there. I mean, if I was the priest, I mean, that was like, you know, it's like the band, you know, LeVon Helm's going to walk in at that point.
Well, you know, you hope that you've developed certain skills through your musical career. My experience with TV necessitated having to really learn how to, you know, read and write drum music for me.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, I don't think I get an A in music composition class, mm-hmm. but it works for me.
Yeah.
And although I'm excellent at reading Jimmy Vivino's charts, and he writes excellent, very dense charts. But you know, you do that for 15, 16 years, day after day. So that helps.
Mm-hmm.
But also, you know, you mentioned Janie Needs a Shooter
or the priest. Yeah.
Like for those songs, okay, now I've got to play like I did in 1978, but better. I got to put myself back in that
right.
that space, that mental musical space,
yeah.
which I'm able to do. I think everybody was able to do it.
Right. And then going to Burning Train, which is just,
yeah,
you know,
one thing we really worked on in the beginning, and it's, you see it in a couple of the documentaries where we used to actually rehearse, was an amazing amount of time spent on analyzing parts. Not only parts, but frequencies where your parts would be heard. Not so much on the drums, but dual keyboards, like staying out of each other's way. And the sound post the first two records kind of evolved out of that, of being aware where everything was. Gary and I, for example, Gary Talent, mm-hmm. we never really ever discussed like locking in, you know, like you read in all the drummer and keyboard magazines and lock. I don't think we ever discussed that. We just play. And the interesting thing about Bruce and the E Street Band, unlike most bands I've ever been in or played with, is that we don't play with each other. We all play with him. And that lends a certain a little roller skating, mm-hmm. You know, you're kind of like going up on edge a little bit because, and in fact, you mentioned Sirius Radio. I live in Florida, I don't drive that much. You know, everything's pretty close. I don't mm-hmm. take long drives like I right. used to in New Jersey. So, but I'll listen to Sirius whenever I'm in the car, and I listen to some of the stuff. And I noticed back in the 70s when we played everything so fast, there was a certain charm to playing that fast, but it was also very, very tight. And what was the, I said to myself, what's the difference compared to like sometimes when I hear now? Well, in those days, we were set up within probably 10 feet of each other. So we were right on top of each other in these clubs, and small
right,
places.
Right, you're going from the Bottom Line, the Roxy, to all of a sudden Slane Castle, you know, with 500,000 people.
Well, and even now, or, where the stage now, is much bigger,
right.
we're much further apart.
Oh, huge stages.
So, you know, there could be 40 feet between Roy and Bruce.
Right.
And he's on a 45-degree angle.
Right.
So the visual thing is quite different, the spatial
right.
thing. That takes some getting used to. Even when we started playing arenas, we were still sort of, you know, in kind of toward the center of the stage. And then when we started, you know, using 17 cameras to project the show,
right.
everything spread out a little bit so you could get your one shot, your two shot, your group shot. Mm-hmm. So it became a little bit more like TV for me.
Right. But speaking of that, you're, you know, as you said, you're laser focused 100% on Bruce because you have to be because he pulls more audibles than any NFL quarterback's ever done.
Oh my God.
You just never know what's coming next. And I've been at so many shows to witness that and blown away. And I'm always wondering, how did these guys figure it out?
Fear.
Fear. Yeah.
It's a great motivator.
Right. But if you don't, but with the larger setups, you know, on the last tour when Bruce is, you know, in center stage doing 10th Avenue Freeze Out or whatever it is, or Hungry Heart being carried, you need to see the signals. How do you pull that off now?
Well, that's a great question. There's one camera dedicated to Bruce wherever he goes, even if he goes behind me or sometimes when he runs off the side of the stage, he's out of my direct view.
Right.
So I have a little TV monitor.
Ah, okay.
So if he goes to the other end, like in the middle of the stadium, usually I can see him because he's on a platform and he'll give cues from out there. And sometimes they're subtle. So I'm able to work between real time and this little camera I have, right? I mean, this little video mm-hmm. screen.
Sure.
It's about the size of a phone.
Yeah, but it's enough for you to see. You may hear him say, take it max, but you kind of need the.
This is my feed. Yeah. It only goes to me. So if I'm playing and you know, I used to be able to turn around.
Right.
Before multiple back surgeries. So now I've got, whenever he goes behind me, I'll be looking at them, then I switch to the the camera.
Exactly.
So I've, you know, technology.
Last E Street related question, but I got to ask it. I mean, everyone has favorites, and it's always a Sophie's choice. But for you, from your perspective and drums, do you have two or three that, God, I hope he puts in the set list that maybe he doesn't occasionally, he puts in occasionally or something that.
Oh, songs?
Yeah, songs.
That we don't play that often?
You don't play that often, yeah. Or some that you do play that often that you just feel so good about playing that you have your own favorite.
Well, I do. I always say when I'm asked that question, Ramrod,
right.
because Ramrod is the simplest beat mm-hmm. in the world.
Right.
But It's been described in print as my sexiest beat,
mm-hmm.
and I like that.
Yeah.
I've seen other drummers, backbeat drummers, friendly beat.
Right.
This is sexy. It's about where you place the two and the four,
mm-hmm.
which is based on where you put the one and the three beat. And anyway, the reason I love it is because I love that song.
Right.
And to me, that's the epitome of what I do. That's Wild Weekend.
Yeah.
And all those songs that I learned how to play drums.
Wipeout,
but particularly listen to the groove on Let's Dance,
right,
which is Earl Palmer, the drummer.
Sure.
So that stuff, and if you're in a stadium full of people and you play that beat, and you see them dancing, it's irresistible. So that's one fun song.
Yeah.
Another fun one for me is Candy's Room, because I started with that.
In Candy's room, there are pictures of her heroes on the wall. But to get to Candy's room, you gotta walk the darkness of Candy's hall. Strangers from the city, call my baby's number.
Right?
Yep.
And about maybe 3 seconds into it, you get this big roar of recognition from the audience. So for that split second, it's Max Weinberg and the E Street Band.
Yeah, it is.
It's the only time in the whole night where it's like, you know.
Oh, it is. It
where I hear that roar from me.
Well, there's a lot of other roars for you, Max, but that moment. But, you know, I would add Roulette maybe to that.
Yeah, Roulette is a...
just because of the beginning. The beginning
is
just so...
On that song, yeah. Bruce had... He gave me that lick, and... But the way he wanted me to play it was not drumistically correct. It made it difficult because normally it's but it was so fast, and he didn't want me to hit the small tom. He was very specific. When you play that, don't hit the small tom. We don't call it the rack tom or the kick drum. It's bass drum, small tom. Don't hit it with your left hand. Do it with your right hand. So, dug a dug a bum bum, I had to go like this, which drumistically was, it took time to get my, so I have to play very much in front of the beat to make the time. It's very fast. About the fastest song we play.
Yeah, without a doubt.
And it came together very quickly. It was like a morning rehearsal.
Right.
He wrote it very quickly and got everybody over there by like 10 o'clock, which was in the middle of the night for all of us, including himself.
Such a great song.
We recorded it that night. It was the first song we recorded for the sessions that would become the River album. But you do get that, you know. And, like, that's a song where there's no margin for error.
No.
Because it's so fast, and it's so, you got to stay so on top of it. And the ending, I never know where he's going to give me the cutoff. It goes digga 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 digga
digga digga digga
digga. It could be anywhere. And he could be in dark. Sometimes, I mentioned this to the light guy, don't turn the lights off completely, because he's still giving cues.
That's true.
And sometimes you got to really squint to see, you know, what he's doing. So... there are those moments, but you try to not let them sweat. See them. You try to have the audience not see you sweat. And JFK and many other philosophers before him often said that courage is grace under pressure, and that's what you try to exhibit when you're on that stage. But the interesting thing, if you were about us performing, if you were dropped on the stage, the first thing you noticed would be how relaxed it is. It's incredibly relaxed, and it may not look that way, but it's energetic, but it's very, very relaxed.
Mm. Well, speaking of relaxed, before we get to Conan, and we'll wrap things up, but one of the best-selling albums, 50 million plus, is Bat Outta Hell.
Yeah.
All right? And, you know, many of us know you were the drummer on 3 or 4 of the main songs on this record.
Or as we refer to it in my family as the one that got away. I got $1,000 to play on that record.
Oh, Max. Oh, my God.
Yeah, then they wanted me to play on the second, so I got considerably more.
Good. I'm glad, because this is just one of the most I mean, you know, iconic albums there are. The songs are iconic. Todd Rundgren's producing, and and we just lost Jim Steinman recently, who obviously did this. And you also played, I think you played on Total Eclipse of the Heart, Bonnie Tyler. I mean, so, you know, which he wrote.
Jim, you know, rewrote that song.
More than $1,000 for that.
Yeah, the fee went up a little bit. Okay. But we had a thing going there in the 70s and early 80s. Actually, I played on Total Eclipse of the Heart and Air Supply's Making Love Out of Nothing at All, which at one point were the number one and two singles on the sort of top 200, right? Or top 100. You know, and they're essentially the same song.
Yeah.
I also have the distinction of playing drums on the only non-successful Barbra Streisand single. And how many people can say that?
That's true. That's true.
Right? It was called Left in the Dark, I think it was called. And it was a Jim Steinman song.
Oh. And is it like not even, you can't even stream it? It's just that?
You probably could stream it.
Okay.
You know.
At least it's out there somewhere.
Yeah.
So it's 1989. You and Becky had a wonderful dinner. You're walking around New York City. A giant redhead on the corner. I don't know what he is. I don't know if he's 7 feet, but I've met him a number of times, including at the last LA Sports Arena show backstage, and had an interesting conversation. Conan O'Brien, you meet him on the corner. It's a long story, and I've heard you talk about it on Conan's podcast, but just kind of how did it all come together so quickly? Because boom, before you know it, you've got this band together, and it's 16 years.
Well, it was actually later than that. The E Street Band broke up in 89, and I was kind of out on the tiles, as this song goes,
right,
for a long time. I didn't play at all. I was in business. I was in the record business in the Shore here. Mm-hmm. It was an outfit called the Musical Heritage Society. It was a mail order record club, one of the largest in the world. And that was interesting. I worked there for 3 years, and I really learned business principles.
Was that like the ones you send the penny to, and you got 15 cassettes, whatever, or 8 tracks going way back?
Get them hooked on a penny, and then, you know, cash cow.
Exactly.
This is pre-internet and pre-computers
doing
that, so it was all mail order.
Yeah.
And anyway, I had gone about, I went to law school briefly.
Right.
It was my midlife crisis. When the band broke out, I was 38. So now it's a few years later, and I was really starting to, what happened to me was my sister got married, and I got asked to sit in with the band at the wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And it was around 91 or 2, and I hadn't played for a few years. The synapses weren't quite working the way they had, you know. I had to think about playing, and I didn't like that feeling, and I'd never felt that feeling. So I started to question the correctness of my move out of being a drummer, right? And whatever that would lead to. But I desperately did not want to be a drummer for hire, or I didn't really have the chops to be a studio guy. It wasn't my thing. I liked being in bands.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't want to go on the road, frankly.
Right.
I had a 2-year-old and a daughter, and Becky was pregnant with our son.
Mm-hmm.
I said, okay, that part of my life's over. I'm gonna do something else. And I meant it. I mean, I was going to go to law school, before I met Bruce, and because if I was going to play, I wanted to do it the way I wanted to do it, and I didn't really see that happening. So, to forestall really forgetting how to play,
mm-hmm.
I called up La Bamba
mm-hmm.
and said, "You're doing weddings. Listen, if one of your guys can't make it, call me. I'll play with you." He goes, "You're kidding." I said, "No." He said, "It pays like $100. I said, "I'll take it." So I started doing bar mitzvahs and weddings with La Bamba and a couple others, but just to play, right? And there's a lot that happens, but the guy named Jerry Augustiniak, who was the drummer for 10,000 Maniacs,
mm-hmm.
got in a bicycle accident and broke his collarbone.
Right.
And somebody called me to sit in with them in what would become actually their last tour. And I did that for about 10 weeks. This was in 92, and I really enjoyed it. I took a leave of absence from the business, and they encouraged me to go because they were a young, hot band. Maybe I'd meet other people, we could record them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I was learning marketing and merchandising and finance, and so I played with them, and suddenly the idea of spending the rest of my life in an office didn't seem as attractive as the dingy dressing rooms you know, the half-dried turkey roll.
Right.
I related to that. I related to the camaraderie on the bus. I said, well, I had tried to like kill off that side of me, and I had been, and it worked pretty well, right? And I started to think of my life as a performer, musician, drummer in the past tense. But that rekindled this, hey, I really do this well. Long to cut to the chase, a friend of mine, an attorney from Los Angeles, had been given, who was a drummer in a band, Jan and Dean's backup band, mm-hmm. called the Fabulous Baggies. And he left drumming and he became a very big TV lawyer. And I met him through Hal Blaine and mm-hmm. we became friends. And anyway, he got the job of putting together the presidential gala for Bill Clinton's first inauguration.
Right. Right.
And he said to me before the election, if he wins, I'll find something for you to do. He wins. I said, what do you want to do? I said, well, you know, I don't know, whatever you think I can do. So he put me to get, he asked, well, we got the New Jersey, Connecticut, New York ball. Mm-hmm. Why don't you put together a show for that? So I did. Called it the E Street Review. This was at Bill Clinton's first inauguration, and Clinton came up mm-hmm. and you know, saw Clarence.
Sense.
He's a
yeah.
big Clarence
right,
fan.
Of course.
And they said, listen, you know, you can ask him, maybe he'll play. So we had an extra sax there, just in case, a tenor sax. And the thing I remember about that, and it leads into how I met mm-hmm. Conan, was he knew Clarence Clemons was going to be at this ball, and it was one of the later balls. Mm. So they said, you know, his people or whoever said, ask him if he wants to play, sit in. Mr. President, I was the band leader, would you like to play with us? And I knew he knew Night Train, he played that mm-hmm. on Arsenio,
right.
So I said, how about Night Train? Mm-hmm. He goes, yeah, I know that one. And then, now he's just, you know, inaugurated as President of the United
right.
States that afternoon, but he had the presence of mind to look at Clarence and say, and not the drummer, and say, what key? Which I thought was really cool. This is a guy who played in bands,
yeah,
right?
Right.
So we had the sax for him. He had a mouthpiece. He brought his own mouthpiece. It was in his pocket. He was looking forward to playing.
Of course with he was.
Clarence
yeah.
Clemons,
yeah.
right?
Well, who wouldn't be?
And he did. And
yeah.
it made new, you know, it was in Time
oh,
magazine.
It was
a
amazing.
Big picture.
Yeah.
And my recompense for mm-hmm. that was getting to be in a sort of all-star band with Greg Fillinganes, Nathan East, David Pack, Steve Stills, to back up Chuck Berry and Little Richard the night mm-hmm. before on the TV show.
Right.
And that was incredible. Mm-hmm. And they had one green room for all the musicians. And there's Dizzy Gillespie's there and all these jazz cats. And everybody was in this big, you know, it was backstage at this arena. And I said, I feel at home here. And that was in January. I decided, like, I got to make a change in my life. And they were holding auditions for the musicians for the Who's Tommy on Broadway. I tend to draw stories out because mm-hmm. there's a lot of detail.
That's all right. It's going to be episode 100 and 101.
Yeah,
we're going to have
three.
A two-parter.
And so, long story short, again, I auditioned for that, and I got the second alternate sub job. That means if the main guy doesn't make it, he calls the sub. He calls the second sub, and he can't make it, then they call me. So, and it pays. It would pay
the
like
Tim
60.
Tebow of drumming at that point. Yeah.
Well, kind of. And I figured I'd never get called.
Yeah.
But a couple of weeks later, I was really happy. It was my first post-Bruce, you know, job that I kind of got on my own.
Right.
And, you know, where it was because of my drumming ability. I had to learn the whole score.
Mm-hmm.
So it had me playing every day. And it was complicated. It wasn't just like playing a rock record.
No.
It was, you know, had a narrative and everything
yeah.
else. So we were, Becky and I, were in New York, and we decided to get a bite to eat at the mm-hmm. Carnegie Deli.
Right.
And there's a story behind that that I won't go into, mm-hmm. but after dinner, we're walking down 7th Avenue, and we get to the corner of 7th and 54th Street. There used to be a place called the Oyster Bar right on the corner.
Mm-hmm.
And this tall, redheaded guy holding a paper bag is standing waiting for the light to turn to go to which was the Riga Hotel,
mm-hmm.
which was
the
on
Riga
54th
Royal,
Street,
yeah.
Riga Royal, right. So I said to Becky, that's Conan O'Brien. And she said, who's Conan O'Brien? I said, well, he's the guy who, he's about 30 feet away. He's
right.
the guy that's taken him for Letterman. And she said, how do you know that? I said, well, he was on Tom Snyder's cable show the other night, and I recognized him. He's like really tall. He's got this big pompadour hair. And she said, well, go over and talk to him. You know, congratulate him at least. So I go over, hey, Conan. The light turns. He stops. Comes back on the curb. I say, hey, it's Max Weinberg from the E Street Band, just to put myself in context.
Right, exactly.
Hey, congratulations on the show. It's a fantastic career thing, opportunity, and blah, blah, blah. And he's very nice. And I said, gee, what are you doing for music? He goes, well, we got some ideas. Why? Do you have any ideas? Which is classic Conan O'Brien, because he doesn't care where the ideas come from as long as they're the best ideas. With his comedy, with he's a great editor. He's egoless. If you got a better idea, that's his thing. And I said, so suddenly it was like, oh man, pitch time. I'm pitching my ass off. And I always carried a copy of this record I produced for Joe D'Elia called Killer Joe. And it was sort of a card, right?
Right.
And I said, well, I produce this. This is what I've got going, you know? So he said, well, you ought to, you know, if you're really interested, call this guy. I called this guy Jim Pitt, who was the music booker. There was no show yet.
Right.
I
had,
you know, this is only, this is May of 93. So I had about half a dozen meetings with various levels of people. And then I get a call at my office at this record club in Ocean Township. Well, we've really liked what you had to say. We'd like to hear the band. I said, okay, fantastic. When do you want to hear us? Well, it was Wednesday. How about Friday? Ah, gee, you know, everybody has, you know, other gigs. Can I call you back? And, you know, so I got off the phone and I was very specific about that. I never said I had a band. I only said I had a great idea for a band, right? I had this record, which was Jump Blues, which Joe D'Elia actually turned me on to, which was, of course, the precursor between sort of swing, combo swing and rock in the 40s and early 50s. And I, you know, that was my pitch. I got this Jump Blues thing. And Buster Poindexter was out there doing that kind of thing. And so I called him back. I said, gee, Jim, you know, a couple of my guys have gigs. What, do you think we could audition for you first thing Monday, through the, after the weekend? He goes, let me see. He calls me back. I worked it out. So, all right, now I had to put a band together.
Right.
So I called. Everybody was away, wait till Sunday.
Right.
And I knew Jimmy Vivino a little bit, who's a phenomenal talent, guitarist, vocalist, and arranger.
Right.
Which is, I knew I'd need that. And plus, I like him. So, you know, that was easy. And his brother Jerry comes along with him wherever they go.
Exactly.
And he's an amazing horn player. So suddenly, I was able to put that band together by Sunday afternoon. Jimmy and I met up Sunday morning. They'd given me sort of a template for five kind of musical motifs that they wanted to hear. They wanted kind of like a Warner Brothers cartoony thing. They had no real jazz, no rock, no funk. Arsenio had a funk band. You can't play Peter Gunn because they all came from Saturday Night Live, and G.E. Smith played Peter Gunn every single Saturday. So they got sick of that song.
Right.
So they had very specific things. And I got it all. So Jimmy and I together, I said, this, we need something bouncy. And we kind of like, we're an old Broadway duo. Hey, I got it. How about this? And he played the piano. Yeah, that's good. So we had these five things together. The band came in that afternoon, the rest of the guys, including Rusty Cloud from Johnny's Southside Johnny's band, who unfortunately only had a budget for seven guys. He was the eighth guy. And he had a riff. It was a New Orleans kind of second line thing. And we rehearsed these five things. And I... they were all, everybody was auditioning at SIR Studios, which, as we all know, was a sort of padded kind of soundstage place. I said, you know, do you mind if we audition at the old Carroll Studios, which is on 39th Street by Port Authority, which looked like a 1940s TV studio? Had the black and green linoleum, the pegboard whitewashed walls. Because I, you know, from what they were telling me, they were into nostalgia.
Right.
So I told everybody in the band to wear the most outrageous Hawaiian-type shirt they could. I had the graphics department make up a bass drum that Becky had kind of sketched out that just had in big letters M-A-X mm-hmm. with a little kind of diagonal,
right.
kind of like the old jazz thing.
Sure.
And I had a little stage built with me on a riser, so I was higher than mm-hmm. everybody, which kind of became a running joke. I always had to be higher yeah. than everybody else. You know,
there were like, a lot of running jokes. On
sort comment. Of like you see me walking, you have yeah. to duck. And, but the drum riser had to elevate me above the band. So, you know, nobody knew anybody. Conan and Robert Smigel and Jim Pitt, they all walked in. Nobody knew who they were. And I hadn't told anybody what it was. I didn't want it to get out. Did our thing. The first two songs were like, we played them well. I don't know whether they went over or not. And I did not want to play the second line beat. It was a little too rock. I didn't want to be associated with rock. And Becky, when I played her the tape the night before, my wife said, that's the best thing you're doing. That little second line. It was like Pocky Way, which right. is a Meters tune. And she said, play that. I said, I don't want to play that. That's too much like rock. I think you should play it. Well, I'm not going to play it. So. Meanwhile, the first two songs were like, well, yeah, we didn't get much of a reaction. So I went into, I said, Becky liked that song. So I started the beat, right? And I said, we called it New Orleans.
Mm-hmm.
And we got into that, and Conan stood up and started dancing like his crazy kind of dance. So if it hadn't been for Becky arguing with me to play that song and me realizing, shit, I got to do something on this third tune.
Amazing how wives.
That's what got us the
right.
gig, yeah. And that's what actually got us the gig. And yeah. and because he and it was actually, he told me later it was the first time he was so happy to get this job.
Right.
He never made any demands.
Sure.
He was. It was the first time he went to Lorne Michaels mm-hmm. and said, "Got to have this band."
Yeah.
And that goes into another whole right. story, which I'm saving for my book. But
yeah, well, let's listen.
So that was
16 years 16 later. Years. The sketches, the stare, the you know, I mean, the drama with the Tonight Show, and I will just tell people if you haven't seen those shows, go on YouTube and just Google Max Weinberg sketches. There, I can't even. Some are not suitable for I don't know what not suitable for most things, but just
today you couldn't do anything. We
yeah,
did.
But they were I mean they're absolutely
no
hysterical.
Way.
But yeah, I don't think although
masturbating bear I don't think
yeah
so.
No. But I do recall you did have the one in bed, and it was Becky.
Well yeah no actually that's that, there's a story behind
that's
that.
Not so take your daughters first, to work we won't go into that
right,
one.
My, yeah. Well, I became known as a bit of the lech.
Yeah.
And I wasn't. But because I wasn't,
but
it was
Conan
funny.
Gave, yeah, exactly.
I was a straight married guy
right,
and
right.
by far the oldest person there. But so I was on vacation, and they had an idea for this. Conan was hosting mm-hmm. SNL. And they had an idea for the final joke of a beat,
mm-hmm.
of a bit,
right.
a beat. And it involved me and a young model mm-hmm. on a desk. And I was in Florida, and I said, well, it sounds great, I'd love to do it, but, you know, how locked are you into me doing
right.
there with this young girl? And his producer, Jeff Ross, said, well, you know, you got any other suggestions? Yeah, have Becky do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she's gorgeous, she looks fantastic, and, you know, and I won't get divorced.
Right. That's what Steven did with Maureen in The Sopranos.
Exactly. So and the sketch was very funny.
Yeah.
And he's, you know, he's giving, it's on YouTube, he's giving people
sketch.
A tour.
Yeah.
He doesn't, you know, hey, my studio's two floors down. Why don't you come with me? And his mother's there. Mom, come with us. And he gathers all these people together, bursts through the airlock doors into our studio. And there I am on his desk, let's say in flagrante delicto mm-hmm. with Becky. And I look up and I go, oh, hi, Conan. Hi, Mrs. O'Brien. And that's the end. And, you know, then it goes into the theme song of Saturday Night Live.
Oh,
and
this is great.
It was funny because they had a new censor. Like, there was actually mm-hmm. a censor. And she came up to me and she said, you know, we've given the show, SNL, the okay for you to do this, but you have to promise me you won't move. When they cut to you, just... Don't move, just,
no
you can
movement.
Do, you know, we're up there on
right.
the thing. I said, okay, I promise. And she came up to me after she was new in the job. She
yeah.
said, thank you because I didn't move.
Right.
She asked me not to, and I realized this is very important to her.
Yeah.
Movement, you couldn't do.
Right.
Positioning, like a tableau.
Right.
They gave them the okay to do.
Right.
So these are my, that's my TV book.
The beauty of late night television, as Bruce says, and I'll add to that, Max is in Hawaii 5-0. You've made cameos in Blue Bloods.
Yeah, I had a recurring role in those shows.
My mother loves Blue Bloods constantly reminds me when you're on. Quickly, I just want to mention Hawaii 5-0 because I found something the other night where you were playing with the Ventures, and you're playing the Hawaii 5-0 theme.
Yeah.
What was that all about?
Well, they
were... Wipeout, I guess.
And Wipeout. Yeah. They were doing, I forget what year it was, but their 25th anniversary for... Mm-hmm. It was a documentary for MTV.
Right.
And they asked a bunch of people to play with them. Mm-hmm. So they, and Mel Taylor had been someone I looked to as a kid.
Sure.
He was the Ventures' second drummer. Howie mm-hmm. Johnson was the first who played on Walk Don't Run.
Right.
Mel was with him for forever.
Right.
And nice guy. And I remember we did it on down near NYU mm-hmm. in a studio, and who was it? It was a Markey? The drummer for the Ramones.
Oh, okay.
Was there also. Mm-hmm. And we did those two tunes. I did Wipeout.
Wipeout and Hawaii 5-0.
And Hawaii 5-0, which was fun.
Right, and then you got to appear on an episode.
Play with the Ventures. People to get the Ventures. Well, not my age, but, you know, the Ventures were basically the Beatles without vocals.
Yeah. So, two quick things, because I know you have this passion for the space industry. You got very close with someone who's been on a number of space shuttle adventures.
Spent more time Commander Jim Weatherby, absolutely.
Right. So the real question is, Jeff Bezos is looking for somebody to go up in space with him. It's only $28 million, Max.
Yeah, I'd have to hit up some wealthy friends I know.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know about the efficacy of going up on your company's first try. Mm-hmm. And you're the owner of the company. So if it was between his company and Elon Musk's company, they've had a little bit more of a track record.
Yeah.
I would definitely love to do it.
Yeah, that was the next question.
Do it in a second. Yeah. But my friend who was a space shuttle commander and at the time logged mm-hmm. more time in space until these extended periods than any other human, Jim Weatherby, mm-hmm. Has really gave me and my family tremendous access to the program. And one of the things he did mention to me is people have absolutely no idea how every second it's so incredibly dangerous that anything can happen. There's a lot of redundancy, but it's not for the the weak-hearted. But he's been very kind, and the one thing I did, so he was the first astronaut to do a MTV hookup. And this happened at the same time I had the Killer Joe record. Mm-hmm. So he called me, he said, send me the record, and if this thing comes off, I'm gonna try to promote the record. So it was a CD, but it was the old CDs with the big packaging, the cardboard.
Sure.
And so he took it up, and he's doing this hookup with it. Well, what are you listening to? Well, I'm glad you asked that, because at the moment I'm listening to this fantastic record, Max Weinberg's Killer Joe. And he starts promoting it. And he's a very shy guy.
Yeah.
He starts promoting it, and which was unbelievable. I got the first extraterrestrial.
I was going to say.
This is before satellite radio. This is MTV.
When the aliens land, they're going to be looking for you.
There's then he lets go of it, and it just floats in the air. Right? And after Danny Federici mm-hmm. died, we gave Jim Danny's record. Mm-hmm. And Danny was a space fanatic as well. And he took Danny's record. He didn't, but he gave it to a crew to take up on a space shuttle mission. Mm-hmm. And they took a picture of Danny's record floating. It's a beautiful picture. It's floating right by the window, mm-hmm. and you see Earth in the back. You know, you can see Earth. It's not a big ball because you're not that high, 300 miles. But you see Danny's album and Earth, and
beautiful.
It was something that Danny Federici would have really loved because he was really into it.
I'm sure. So the jukebox show, let's talk about that tomorrow night, locally here in New York City.
It'll be past news.
Yeah, that'll be past news, but I'm going, so I'm excited about it. But the real news is you're going to be playing with the jukebox band this summer and this fall.
Yeah.
And the concept, for those that haven't seen this show, is just, well, I'll let you describe it, because it is unique to anything I've ever seen, but it is more, listen, we all have great times at E Street Band and Rolling Stones and Goo Goo Dolls. We love all of our concerts, but this is so unique.
Well, this basically grew out of my love of the records I grew up with as a kid, and learned how to play drums by playing two. And I was one of those guys who would sit there for hours with all the bass off so I could like figure out all the parts that I knew, mm-hmm. these drum parts. And in those days you could do that. And so I was doing a show in Chicago, April of 2017, with the what I call the jukebox, because it's all basically cover songs. And in the jukebox, the original jukebox, and I have subs now, but mm-hmm. are the three members of the Weaklings,
right?
Who's everybody's favorite band from mm-hmm. around here: Bob Berger, Glenn Burtnick, mm-hmm. John Merjavi.
Right.
And we were going to do a set, and people wanted more, and,
right.
and we didn't have any songs. We were done. So I said, "All right, well, what do you want to hear?" "Well, you know, Under My Thumb." Mm-hmm. "All right, we can play Under My Thumb." Mm-hmm. So then we played for another 2 hours of just requests from this audience,
right.
at this place called Space in Evanston, Illinois. Mm-hmm. And it was really fun, and it really involved the audience. "Well, what are you, I want to hear Glory Days. Well, are you ready to sing it? Mm-hmm. Will you sing it with us?" You know, it was a bunch of fraternity guys, so they all came up. So it was like, my manager said, "That was fantastic. I mean, the first set, you know, yeah, we've heard those songs, but you know, if you can do that." So we've done about 225 of these shows. COVID, of course, stopped everybody.
Right.
And a lot of the places I play probably are not closing, mm-hmm. or I mean, are not opening again. Bigger rock clubs, small
sure.
performing
right.
arts places. And it's really fun because we draw from a list of about a little over 200 songs. The guys are great because they're really detailed. You know, mm-hmm. they'll argue for hours of
right.
what chord that is. So what I try to do is play the right tempo of these songs. Because bands always play these songs. When you play Midnight Hour, it's a slow song. Mm-hmm. And also all the groups that did it originally, they, for their Vegas-y type shows, they sped up all these songs. I like to play the original record. So, and I say, you know, if you come to see this show, you're gonna hear those songs played at manly tempos. These are play them like a man, you know? And, because it takes a man to play a slow tempo. Al Jackson was the greatest slow tempo drummer of all time. But so I'm doing 45 shows between now and New Year's.
That's great.
And it works out to, you know, 2, 3, 4 a month.
Right.
You know, a lot of them are outside this summer. They're
right.
all over the place.
Yeah, I know you're. I think you're finishing up here in Red Bank in Camp
yeah,
Basin
right
Theater,
before
which
Christmas,
which will be great. And it's again, as someone who's been there and made the mistake of saying, "Max, play Fire," and Max said, "All right, Mitch, come on up and sing." You can find that on YouTube, and I apologize.
Well, here's my business philosophy of my music career.
Yeah.
So, you know, when you're a kid, you want to be in a band.
Right.
And then you become someone like a Bruce.
Right.
I want to have a band. And then you get to be sort of my age. I want to hire a band, and I'm a drummer. So what I do, was it New Year's Eve? I got this great gig 10 minutes from my house, mm-hmm. the Boca Resort, New Year's Eve gig. I generally don't play. They made me literally an offer I couldn't refuse. So they wanted a big kind of Sly Stone meets James Brown meets Bruno Mars and mm-hmm. all their descendants. And it's songs that I've heard, but it's not my generation. So, okay, I went out and I found the best band that was that description from Miami. And I paid their drummer to stay home for the night. Mm-hmm. So I found that it's economically a better model to go get an existing band who knows all these songs and have me learn them and write them
right.
out, right? Taylor Swift, you know, Shake It Up.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm, which is what people want to dance to.
Right.
So I'm gonna, if a gig calls for, okay, you got to play, you know, current pop, I'm not going to try to foist my 60s sensibility.
Right.
Because I've noticed that it's very difficult for young people today to dance to Motown records.
Right.
They just, it's not their beat. They want to hear that constant bass drum.
Yeah.
So that's the thing. I go out with the jukebox. Literally, we have no crew. Mm-hmm. I set the drums up. You know, otherwise it would be, you know, setting the drums up is the most mechanical thing I know how to do. Putting in the tubes,
right.
Getting them all just right.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm happy to have someone else do them when someone else is paying for them.
Right.
But if I have to pay for it, I'm going to do it myself. And that's my business philosophy.
That's a terrific philosophy. Well, we're going to end on this because it's a question I've asked for 99 shows, so got to end it here. And I always credit Tim Ferriss from Tribe of Mentors. It was one of many questions he had in his book. So, Max, a giant billboard is available for you. It could say anything, okay? It's your message to the world. What would you put on that billboard and why?
What would I put on that billboard and why? I would put calm down. Because that's what we all need to
do. Honestly, that's
today.
Wow, what
calm
a great answer.
Down.
I thought I've heard them all. That's terrific. That's so true. Well, Max, thank you so much, first of all, for being here.
It's good to be with you. I hope I haven't bored you listening to me yap around.
No, this has been great. I want to, first of all, again, thank you for being here. I'm looking forward to seeing you tomorrow night. Of course, thank everybody at Danny Clinch's Transparent Gallery. If you haven't visited here in Asbury Park, get here, find Tina. She will show you everything in this gallery. I have to thank Tina for everything that she's done. It's much more than a photo gallery. Trust me, there's furniture.
I will second that. You got to come down to Danny Clinch's in Asbury Park. You walk outside, you can see Convention Hall. This is unbelievable. This is my first time here because I don't live in New Jersey anymore. And if where I live in Florida had something like this, it'd be packed. Well, it's pretty packed today. We've got a nice group of people here. Come down to Danny Clinch's. You're going to love this place.
Well, I second that emotion. And I just want to thank Brett and Chris for and Zach for all the tech help and Resonate Recording, who's done a great job editing the first 99 episodes and now 100, 101, and 102. No, I'm joking. We're going to keep it as 100. It's been a great ride, and I really appreciate everybody that's listened to Financially Speaking. We'll be back. We're going to take a little break and come back in the fall with some more great episodes. And as we say every year or every episode, when saving for your financial future, which, Max, I certainly hope includes an E Street Band tour next year. And I know you're not going to break that news today, but we've kind of heard Stephen and Bruce kind of hint towards that. So we certainly all have our fingers crossed for that.
Well, there's a lot of music to be made and played. And as long as you're healthy and can rise to the occasion, I don't see why not. It's certainly fun. And having experienced what we've all experienced over the last 15 or 16 months, wouldn't it be nice to have a shot of Bruce Springsteen and the E Street Band as an antidote to the just the unique, awful period we just are coming out of, it seems. And, you know, again, that's above my pay grade to know what Bruce has in store for the rest of us. And I don't ask, and it's worked out for 47 years, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I just, look, hey, I'll say to Becky, look outside, look at the bus.
Mm-hmm.
See ya.
It'll be the greatest booster shot we could all have, so. Thank you again, Max.
Mitch, my
pleasure. Appreciate
it.
It's been a pleasure. Max, would you do us a favor and maybe play us out? And I might have Danny Clinch. Danny Clinch is here, I think. Yeah, and he is. Come on, jump up on stage.
Well, I just haven't noticed you have a drum set.
We just happen to have a drum set here.
With apologies to DW Drums.
Yep.